Shalom everyone. Today we are going to study Parashat Toldot. We can find it in the book of Bereshit, Genesis, chapter 25, verse 19. That's where the parasha starts. This parasha is going to be read the whole week till Shabbat, including Shabbat. And most of the times Parashat Toldot is already, it's part in a in the month of Cheshvan, Scorpio, and partially in the month of Kislev. This year, Rosh Chodesh Kislev is starting on Thursday night, so Shabbat is just the second day of Kislev. Okay, and how is that connected to, you know, whatever we're going through around the world right now, because the world is going through really excessive period of reforming, restructuring. A lot of stuff is fighting to survive because it's not up to date anymore. A lot of stuff is still hanging there. And we are simply in between because we have no idea how it's going to look like. What? The world that we are facing, how it's going to look like, we have no idea. And we know, I think if each one of you remembers, many times when we go through a crisis, it's very, very painful, very, especially the most, if you notice, the most important part of the pain is the doubt and the lack of knowledge. What are we facing? Where is it going to? Because if I know that everything is going to turn out right, you know, it's not that painful. Doesn't matter what we go through, you know, we don't have problem to go through hardships as long as we know that the future is guaranteed. The problem is that we have no idea how the future is going to look like. And then, you know, the same thing as birth. Birth is very painful. Okay, very painful. And when the child is coming out, after a while we forget the pain and we celebrate the birth of the child. The same thing when we have to give birth to our new selves, our new design, let's say, our better selves. And when finally we reach that place of, aha, okay, now I know what it was all about because I really find myself in the right place. If I just knew what it's going to look like, I won't be that horrified. I won't behave in such a terrible way. I won't be controlled by anxiety, and that won't make me so angry sometimes and so upset and do so many things that I regret for doing them. Correct? So it's a lot about the certainty about what's going to be the outcome of the procedure. And we are, the whole of humanity is going right now, as I said a few years ago, just in the beginning of 5780, we're going through a really rough time, which means nothing that by the end of this decade, the rules are going to be different. And we already know that the rules are different because so many things are behaving in such a difference than whatever we knew in the previous decade, and we were sure that the previous decade was crazy enough. And then comes this decade and proves to us that nothing is that too crazy. If you think something is very crazy, tomorrow is going to prove to you that you were really, really conservative. So, as we say, hold on, buckle up, and we're going for the ride. So Parashat Toldot is very, very important for especially every year's ride. Okay, Toldot means offsprings, means yield, results, the fruits of. In Hebrew, it's coming from the Shoresh, Yud Lamed Daled, Yeled, a child, Yalda, a girl child, okay? Laledet, to give birth, which means it's all about what is being giving birth, and that's, and it means Ela Toldot Yitzchak Ben Avraham, Avraham Olid et Yitzchak. These are the results or the offsprings or the outcome of Yitzchak, the son of Avraham. That's the name of the parasha. Avraham Olid et Yitzchak. We know that Avraham brought to the world Yitzchak, Holid, again using the same thing. But what we know, when what is that we know? We don't think that the Torah is just to tell you about the dynasty of the founding fathers of Judaism or monotheism, whatever name you want to call it, right? Because, you know, the Jews see Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as their forefathers, founding fathers, same with Christianity, same with Islam. Okay, so we're talking about the birth of the idea. When we read the Torah is never about telling us a story. It's all about giving us the birth or the creation of a consciousness that we need to attain or achieve for ourselves in order to achieve success in our lives. So we understand, and we read it before, that Yitzchak came from Abraham, okay? But the name of the parasha, the Toldot Yitzchak, so what is coming out of Yitzchak is an extension of what started with Abraham bringing to the world Yitzchak. But we know, where it says Avraham olidet Yitzchak, we know that Avraham had other children. He had Ishmael, he had the sons of Keturah. Okay, why does it say Yitzchak? Because when we're speaking about an idea, the idea of chesed, the idea of loving kindness as a cosmic force that every human being must develop as a major part of his life. It's like, it's a pillar of faith, a pillar of consciousness, a pillar of behavior. That it's a, as we said also, it is a program that you cannot, when you turn on yourself in the morning, if you don't turn on the program of Avraham, Chesed, you're not in the game yet. Okay, same thing with Yitzchak. And Yitzchak, we spoke a lot about Avraham and Yitzchak. Avraham, again, brings to the world Yitzchak because Chesed, when you start with Chesed, then you can, the next step will be Gevurah. You start with your right foot, but then you have to walk with the left foot. If you continue walking with the right foot, you just find yourself walking in circles, right? In order to move forward, you need the left foot. You can't cancel the left. The left is a must be part of every system. Same thing in electricity, the plus and the minus, it's a must. You can't cancel neither of them. Otherwise, there won't be a circuit. Okay, so here the story. In the previous parasha, we learn about the completion of that force of chesed and gevurah, loving kindness and judgment, and how they must come together in the binding of Isaac into a third force, which is the synthesis between the two. You cannot just breathe out the same way you can't just breathe in. You can't just open a business and make money, you have also to spend money. You cannot just spending money, you have to make money. Which means you have in every giving, there must be a receiving. In every receiving, there must be a giving. Otherwise, neither of them can exist. So we build that in Parashat Chayei Sarah and the Vayera before that. Now, it's about the completion of the... Because it says, Ele Toldot Yitzchak. These are the outcomes, what came out, what was born out of Yitzchak. Right? So what came out of Yitzchak are Isaac and Esau, Jacob and Esau. However, it's not that simple. Before that, we have another thing. Verse 20, Vayitzchak ben 40 shana bekachto את רבקה בת בתואל. So Yitzchak is 40 years old when he takes Rivka. Remember, he was 37 years old at the end of the previous parasha. During the binding, he was 37. So according to this, he is 40 years old, which means Rivka was 3 years old. Okay? No wonder she couldn't give birth late. Okay? However, still we know when she gave birth, that was 20 years later. Okay, she was 23. 23, those days, is a very old age for a first child. Okay? Those days, people got married age, you know, girls got married age of 12. Okay? 12, that was a day, because, you know, that was a time. So, you know, 11 years later, to give birth, that's a problem. So, the story is, why is it that Abraham and Sarah had a problem to bring a child? Isaac and Rivka have a problem to bring a child. Jacob and Rachel, even Leah, it was not easy. They had 12, but they didn't come for free. And we asked the question, why is it that some people have it so easy and some people it's so hard, the most, you know, basic stuff in life, it's so hard for them. And we have these questions, and we have more questions in this parasha. Still, so verse 21, ויתר יצחק לאדוני לנוכח אשתו, כי הכרה היא, ויעתר לו אדוני ותר רבקה אשתו. So, verse 21 says, so Yitzchak is praying, but the word is ויעתר. It's more, ויעתר is like more than praying, is requesting, imploring, but in very intensive way, in front of his wife. But we'll see finally, because ki akarai, because she was barren, she could not have a child. Looks like that was going in the family. Okay? Vayater lo Yitzchak ad Adonai. But finally, the Creator, Hashem, gave him his request. And what's really special is it's the same letter, but a different vowels. Vayetar, he implored, he begged, he requested. Vav yud ayin tafresh. Vayater, and he gave him his wish. Vav yud ayin tafresh, exactly the same letters, just the vowels are different. Okay? There's a secret over here. And then Vatar, Rivka Ishto, and Rivka became pregnant. Okay, so the Zohar is giving us a very important explanation about what really happened over there. So, okay, yes. So the Zohar, Parashat Toldot, verse 19. The Zohar is asking, Patach Rabbi Yehuda v'tei v'amar. Rabbi Yehuda opened later and said, he is quoting the same verse that we just quoted. Ma'u v'yeta, what does it mean v'yeta? What is the meaning of that verb? Dekarev le'korbana. So he brought an offering. Vetzalei Allah, and he prayed. Uma korbana karev, ola karev. Dichtiv vayater lo Hashem. Tivhacha vayater lo Hashem. Tivhatam vayater Elohim la'aretz. Ma le'alan korban, ofkan korban, ktiv vayater Yitzchak, ktiv vayater lo, lenafak esha mile'ela, lekivla esha diltata. So, translation. What does it mean that the word vayetar, he learns it from another place in the Torah, that he brought a sacrifice, an offering. Because it says so, he brought an offering. And what does it mean? She yatzah eshel mala, a fire came from above, coming from the fire that is from below. Because you need two fires for the offering to be consumed. Eshel gavoah ve'eshel hediot. A fire of the above and a fire of the below. Vayetar Yitzchak u'al eshel mata vayater lo Hashem u'al eshel mala. Why the two words exactly the same words? Because what you awaken from below, if your offering, if your prayer is like fire that comes from below with so much devotion, with so much closeness to God, then a fire will come from above and fulfill your wish. And a person, when he prays, he needs to feel like he's going on fire, that he's bringing himself as an offering to the Creator. Why? Because if you pray from the place of I want, I need, it comes to me, you know, I'm entitled to it, you're not going to get it. Because it's a fire of negative passion. It's a fire of desire to receive for the self alone. But if it is a fire from a prayer that is coming from a total elevation, total desire to connect to the Creator above, like Korban Ola, it's a Ola offering, which means it's all going up. When a person is totally exalted and elevating himself, like going on fire, then the fire will come from above and fulfill and grant his or her wish. But then, verse 20 gives another aspect. That it's not, I won't say it is eliminating the first one, but it's an addition. Verse 20, it says, "Perush acher, v'akatuv v'yatar Yitzchak." Another explanation. "Sheitpalel tfilato," that when he prayed his prayer, "v'chatar chatira lemala, ela mazal ha-mashpia banim." When he prayed, he created like a tunnel connecting to the above, to that place that gives, to the place that is called Mazala. What is Mazala? We learned many times about the Mazala. The 13 attributes is bringing the light for Mazala. Mazala is the highest level of which we can bring in or basically connect to the original cause of the creation, which is the will of the Creator to share and do good with all of us, with every creature. When we connect to that place, it's called Chatira. Chatira, it's like, you know, somebody's in prison and he's digging a tunnel out of prison to freedom. That's called Chatira. Okay? Chatira is when you dig and you make a tunnel and you break through the impossible thick walls and you come out from your prison out to freedom. That's a verb, Chatira. When is that we achieve Chatira? When we reach that place. The hint, I think, is when it says, Vayetar Yitzchak la'Adonai lenochach ishto. Nochach means in front of. But that is, you know, in front of his wife, which means she was, you know, so the Midrash is saying, he was praying on this corner, she was praying in that corner. Nochach means facing. But the Zohar says there's a very powerful verse that speaks about it in the book of just a second. Okay, that's in the book of Proverbs, chapter 4, verse 25. And it says over there, Einecha lenochach yabitu. Your eyes should look forwards, in front of. The same word, lenochach. And the Zohar, in another place, the Zohar says, what does it mean? What is the great wisdom of King Solomon, the wisest man on earth, saying, you should look forward. What are we getting out of it? Nochach, okay? One of the most famous piyutim that have a very powerful power of prayer and achievement is Nishmat Kol Chai. Nishmat Kol Chai. We say it on Shabbat and Chagim and holidays after Shirat Hayam, after the Song of the Red Sea. Okay, the initials, says the Arizal, Nishmat Kol Chai, Nochach. Nochach. So what's the big deal in that? Nochach is numerical value, says the Arizal, of 78. And 78 is Gimatria Mazala. Mazala is three times, oh, it's also three times Yudkei Vavkei. Yudkei Vavkei, the tetragrammaton, numerical value 26, right, left, and center, three times, you get 78. 78 is Nochach. What's special about it? So the Zohar says, when Yitzchak Avinu prayed, he reached so high because he didn't connect to his will. And there are many, many discussions in the Midrashim about it. Was he praying that Rivka will give birth? No, he prayed, you know, God, I know that Yaakov must come out, Jacob must come out, the central column must come out. You know, not for me. I have a job. I have a job to bring a boy that will be the central column. Okay? This boy must come out. And I want to connect to your will. I know that you want that child to come out because he has to become the Merkava of the central column. And that's why I connect to your will, so whatever needs to open up will open up, and that child will come out. How? I have no idea. Through Rivka, through somebody else. You know, I'm not telling you, God, how to solve the problem. I'm just praying to connect to your own will. And what's the will of God? To do good. Very simple, just to do good. And that means that when we pray to that place, we pray to that place that is called Mazala, okay? That is the meditation of three times the tetragrammaton. We pray to that place that the Zohar says, Mazala sheperusho dikna darich anpin. It's the bird of the Keter, the second part of the Keter. Okay, because birth, sustenance, can, when you connect to that place, everything can happen. Especially in what is called sustenance, children, and life. If somebody is decreed to die, he can change it to life. Somebody is decreed, and when we learned about the prayers of Rosh Hashanah in Yom Kippur, we had in the prayers few times, four times in every prayer, Uvechen. Gimatria, the numerical value, 78. Nochach. So we have in this parasha the ability to dig out from the dungeon that we're stuck in and to reach above everything else. And how do we know? Shekatuv, as it says, later on, okay, about the prayer of Hannah. Hannah, the mother of Shmuel, the prophet Samuel, she also could not give birth. Finally, it says, "Vatitpalal al Hashem." She prayed above Hashem. Above the Yud-Kei-Vav-Kei, what does it mean? Yudke Vavke is about rachamim, mercy. But when we go back to the crossing of the Red Sea, and the Israelites are standing there on the Red Sea, and they're facing, they can't, you know, in front of them it's the sea, on the right side it's mountains, on the left side mountains, behind them it's Pharaoh. And they're praying. First time they pray as a nation, as a conscious, free nation, okay? They step up on the stage of history as a nation. Before that, they were slaves. Whatever they did, they didn't do anything till that moment because, you know, the 10 plagues, that was Moses and Aaron. Nothing to do with the Israelites. They're praying as a nation and they pray and God is telling Moses, what are you yelling at me? Ma titzak elai. Daber al bnei Yisrael ve'isau. Speak to the children of Israel and let them travel. And the Zohar is asking, travel where? Al hayam hayuchonim. They were camping on the sea. And the answer the Zohar says, ma titzak elai. It's like you have to go above al Hashem. Above that place of mercy. Most of the times, when we have a problem, like putting the right and the left together, achieving that place of central column, usually that can appease the judgment and we can move on. But there are certain times that you have to travel to a higher place. And that higher place is called mazala. And that higher place is a place that when you have real certainty, it's not certainty in yourself, certainty in the will of the Creator to share, love, and protect you. When you connect to that place without any judgment, without any, what's the word? Remember we spoke before about the fire. It's a total fire. Ola, the offering that is called Ola, is burnt offering. Nothing is left, which means you burn all your expectations, you eliminate all your expectations, and you connect only to the pure will of the Creator to give. Okay? And when you connect to that, something new will come out from the most unexpected place. Nobody prayed to God on the Red Sea so to be able to walk on the sea. They didn't even ask God to kill the Egyptians. Okay? They simply connected to God, you know, just do whatever, you know, we'll do whatever you tell us to do. And then he crossed the sea. The result was crossing the sea. You know, that was not one of the logical answers or solutions, but it worked. Okay? That's what it means, Vayetar. Lachato chatira. Why lachato chatira? Because we are all imprisoned with our own old belief systems. The biggest culprit in our lives is being stuck in the old belief systems. That's why Rabbi Ashlag says again and again, when you stuck to the past and all what you thought is right in the past, that is in Hebrew, avar. Avar, past. But the female of avar is avera, transgression. When you are holding on to the past, why? If you continue to do what you used to do, you continue to get what you used to get. And that means that the Creator does not want us to continue to regurgitate the same old stuff. So the surrounding light, what is the surrounding light? The potential light that is there destined to come into us is starting to put pressure. And that pressure means when something big wants to come into a small vessel, what happens? Pressure. And the pressure could reach pain. And the pain has two outcomes. One outcome, the more painful a human being is, the more he contracts and closes down. And that's what kills people. And people, when they go through hardship, many of them shut down, close down, and they start dying because they simply gave up on the future. They are holding on nostalgia, on how great the good old days were. Instead of letting go of the past and giving space for a glorious future that you can't even imagine, it's beyond your vessel of today. So if we don't want for the Suranilite to kill us, which means it doesn't kill us, we kill ourselves when we refuse to let go and move on. Okay? And why it's not that it's killing us? Because when we refuse and we give up on a brighter future, that's when we start to die. And when a person physically dies and he comes up and he realizes that it was a big, big, miss, that there was such a great future waiting for him, and he just said no, because he was complaining about somebody taking from him his past, while the past was so terrible relatively to the future that was coming. So what happens when a person realizes that? He has to come back to another lifetime. So finally, he will embrace the future and let go of the past. And that can take a few lifetimes. That when the pressure comes in, we embrace it and use the pressure to move on instead of letting out or declaring defeat and simply letting go of life. You know, when there is pressure, without pressure, there's no birth. Remember, what's the word that the parasha is? The name of the parasha is Toldot, giving birth, bringing outcomes. Laledet, in Hebrew, to give birth is laledet. It's from the same verb as Toldot. How do you give birth? Pressure, unbearable pressure. And what happens when the pressure is mounting? When there are, you know, when it's very strong pressure, that's a time for the mother, the pregnant mother, to push, right? And in between contractions, it's time to rest. So you use the pressure to give birth, to bring a new you, instead of cursing the pressure, like, I don't want you. I don't want you over here. Don't come. Don't see me. Like, go away. I want to stay the same. You know, the baby cannot stay inside. The baby has to come out. But, you know, women, unfortunately, some of them die during birth. It's like sometimes the pressure kills them instead of bringing them the blessing of coming out. That is what we are talking about. The moment we have that faith that the will of God is so great and so positive and so much greater than anything we can think about, so how do we reach that place? So let's go back to the meditations of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, the two stages. If you go also to the seventh day of Pesach, one stage is scanning the 72 names of God. When you scan the 72 names of God, which is, it gives you the ability to rise above all of that is called the past. And by the way, I just thought about it. Avar in Hebrew, past, starts with Ayin Bet. What's the Reish? Reish is the letter that created Mercury. And what is about Mercury? Innovation. Innovation, the hunger for knowledge, the hunger for new stuff, the boredom from the past, and the excitement about the future. That's a letter Reish. It's about having that desire and hunger and thirst for something new. So it has to be done in this. So the healing is inside the problem. So the Ayin Bet, the 72 names, with the passion for something new, with total trust in the Creator, and after that, meditating on the three times the name of God, Yud-Kei-Vav-Kei, right, left, and center. So that, if we really meditate on that strongly, we can reach to a place in which we can simply make a tunnel through the walls of our prison and come out to freedom, although logically it is totally impossible. And you know what? We are not here to do what's possible. We're here to do what is impossible. Why? Because we want to be creators. And to be a creator means not recycling, but really recreating. When do we really feel excited and happy? Only when we connect to the image of God within us. And the image of God means to be a creator. That means creating light out of darkness, possible out of impossible, sweet out of bitterness. This is the name of the game, okay? And that has to be. If we want it easy, forget it. That there's no creativity in easy. Okay, so people that have their lives very easy, very predictable, they never reach true happiness. And that brings us again to the main disease of our generation. Our generation is maybe the most spoiled generation in history of humanity. As I said before, the generations of the few past centuries or millennia, they, most people lived as slaves to tyrants. So we call them great emperors and great kings and stuff like this. But remember, who wrote history? The slaves of these tyrants. So all of these tyrants, all of these great kings of the past and emperors, they basically were robbers and killers and murderers, and with power comes the corruption. And if you learn about all of those courts of kings, it was all treachery, poison, killing, murder, and stuff like this. Terrible. And most of it was a very small, always in the history of humanity, very small amount of people. They were the royals, and they were living out of robbing the rest of the people, okay? And the rest of the people lived a life without any human rights. Any human rights, the king could take from them anything he wanted. And if not the king, his servants, which basically were his colleagues or the people he trusted. And the award that the people that trusted him and got him to power was to give them the permission to rob the people. Okay? And again, why is it that we don't read it enough? Because the people wrote history were the servants of those tyrants. Okay? So, for two centuries, humanity is fighting for freedom. We're talking about the American Revolution, the French Revolution, and more revolution, and then all over, like since the late 1700s, 1800s, 1900s, huge wars, millions of people were fighting and giving their lives so we can have an era in which we have a kind of a democracy, which means the people in power, they do not rob us all the way. They leave to us more. And the result is because people had more ownership, the productivity level went up, and there was more wealth in the world, so even the common people could have that share. So we reached a place that today, somebody works, you know, for an average salary, he has an apartment, or he rents an apartment with a bathroom. Only rich people, for most of history, had a bathroom close to their living room. Most people had to go outside the house for a bathroom, right? So we are very rich and very spoiled, and especially after the World War II and after the Cold War, the world has changed so much, and it's like we raised a new generation that felt it's the end of evil, the end of negativity, because everybody lives in a just society, a real pure democracy, and there's no more injustice, there's no more inequality. And if there is some inequality, that should be wiped away immediately, because everybody's entitled to easy, nice life. And the generation of the people that were born after World War II worked really hard to bring everything to their children. And the generation after too. And the problem is that the generation came that don't remember what does it mean to fight the Nazis, or to fight the horrors of Stalin's communism, or to fight the, it's like, still, the part of the world is still in that darkness, I have to admit. But nobody speaks about it anymore. Nobody, it's all about, we live in a la-la land of, you know, the only problem we have is global warming. We have no enemies anymore. Everything is over. The problems are over. There's no more executions in the places that, like, there's still tyrannies. There's still dictatorships. There's still horrible places around the globe in which people can be executed just like this. That was the horror of ISIS. But ISIS is not the only one. There's so many countries around the world that are still doing that. But most of the people that we know, you know, when we live in a big part of the world, we grew up with entitlement. And this parasha is that entitlement is not what we have to face. Why? Because we still did not fix the desire to receive for the self alone. And the story goes on with the birth, that instead of one boy that will grow up to become the central column, the chariot for the central column, Rivka is giving birth to twins, Yaakov and Esav. Okay? Why? Why should, if Rivka and Yitzchak are so righteous, why do they deserve to have a boy like Esav? Right? And Rivka, she realizes something wrong during her pregnancy. We read it on chapter 25, verse 22. Vaitrotzatzu habanim bekirba. It's a double meaning word. The word vaitrotzatzu, it means, and the boys were running inside her, chasing each other, beating each other. Vaitrotzatzu also, velerotzetz means in Hebrew to break somebody's head. It's like they were going head to head. Inside her, they were fighting. And she couldn't bear that pain. So she went, she was asking God, what is it that I have inside? And verse 23, Vayomer Adonai Lain, God said to her, Shnei goyim bevitnech, the two nations in your belly. Shnei lumim emayach yiparedu. Two nations will come out of out of you. And one will fight the other. Okay, that will be a world war forever. So she is going to give birth, and two are coming out. Vayetze harishon admoni, the first one is a redhead, is red, very red, full of hair, and his name is called Esav. Verse 26, and then came out another one holding the heel of Esav, and that's why he was called Yaakov, because the word Yaakov has the word Akev, a heel in his name. So, what's in it for us? Vayigdalu anarim, verse 27. Vayi Esav ish yodea tzayid, ish sadev, Yaakov ish tam yoshev olim. Esav was a hunter, a man of the field. Yaakov was, it says, ish tam, innocent. He was sitting in the tent studying with the sheep. He was not playing the game in the world outside. Okay, and there are a lot of midrashim about it. What does that mean? Because when you come to this world, you must have the two abilities. One way, you must be a person of learning, studying, with a lot of innocence, with a lot of purity, and also with the humility. You know, he's holding the heel of his brother. On the other hand, a real spiritual person must also be able to hold that idea that you have to come out to the world and you have to know how to fight and win in this wild, crazy world that we live in. Okay? Both were supposed to be the two sides of the central column. However, many of the sages are saying, Esav was not destined to be evil. He simply chose that destiny. And when he chose that destiny, and that came after his bar mitzvah, no one could foresee that. Because why? Because a human being has a free will. Till his bar mitzvah, he had no choice. They were like two kids. And who raised them? It says that Abraham raised both boys. And then it says that Yitzchak loves Esav, Verivka, she loves Jacob. You know, that's very not recommended. That the kids know that the father loves one son and the mother loves another son. Okay, you have to show love to both kids. And you cannot show any kid that you love another kid. Definitely, that's you, you just, you know, it's troubles are there already. Still, we have to remember there's a lesson for us. And the Zohar is going into a very deep teaching that I spoke a lot about it in previous years, that Vayazed Yaakov Nazid, it says verse 21, 29, and Jacob is making a stew. Okay? But the question is why the word is Vayazed Nazid. I think it's the only place in the Torah that this verb is mentioned this way. And the Zohar is saying the word Vayazed also means consciously, purposely focusing on something. Jacob is a central column. And when a person is taking in that force of central column, you need to be always ready for the fight. You have to be always making the stew. What is a stew? A stew is a mixture of few ingredients, right? They start as different ingredients, but they come out as one dish, okay? And what's special about it? It's synthesis. Jacob is about synthesis. It's about synthesizing. On one hand, I have to be a person of chesed and loving kindness. On the other hand, I have to be also able to awaken the judgment, which means put a boundary for myself and for others. So that has to be always the synthesis of Vayazed Nazid. Every day, the whole day, we have to be cooking that stew that is called success. Success is not falling from the heavens. Success is a very strong energy that is being created by always bringing together the chesed and the gevurah, the loving kindness and the judgment. On one hand, there is the water. Let's go back again to business. On one hand, people should feel the water energy in your business. What is water energy? Loving kindness. Because what is it everybody wants? Everybody wants to feel cared for, supported, and people are willing to pay for it and to stay loyal to that service, no matter what service that you're giving, right? It could be people that pay you, it could be your could be your colleagues at work, that basically you serve them, you support them in order for a bigger goal. Okay, so let's say you're not serving a customer, but you have to serve somebody else. In order to have, to raise your status, you people need to feel from you chesed. On the same time, you need gevura. And gevura is about putting your boundaries. You can't just give. You have to say sometimes, I'm not capable of giving that what you're asking from me. And gevura means also fire. Remember about the fire. When you give, and you give kind of a laid-back way, it's not the same as when you give with fire, with excitement, with passion. That has to come from the left side. That has to come from the judgment side. Okay? So, but that is a different Yaakov. That's not Yaakov. That is what Esav was supposed to be. Esav was supposed to be that person that on one hand, it says in one of the Midrashim that the babies were running inside. And what does it mean? When Rivka was pregnant, when she passed by a place of idol worshiping, Esav was trying to get out. When she was passing by a place of the worshiping of Shem, Yaakov was trying to get out. Okay, so the simple thing is Esav wanted to join idol worshiping. But some of the commentators are saying, no, he wanted to get out to destroy that place of idol worshiping. Which means that two kinds of tzaddikim, two kinds of righteous people. One kind is like Yaakov. He's sitting in a tent, minding his own business, studying Torah, very laid back. He's like secluded from the rest of the world. And by the way, finally he had to get out of it and to fight with his terrible uncle, who was a killer, a murderer, a cheat, a liar, and a master of the dark arts, right? But still, Jacob did it in a very passive way. Esav was supposed to be the one who does it in a very assertive way. And to be assertive, you need a lot of fire. Okay? So these are the two sons of Yitzchak and Rivka, which means that the two aspects of a tzaddik, the two kinds of tzaddikim. The one is the outgoing, that is very assertive, that is the leader, that he can carry millions of people after him. You know, when we're talking about the Messiah, we mean somebody who knows to run not just a nation, the whole world. He must have that energy, that fire of Esav. Because if you're laid back and you're just like, you know, ishtam, you cannot, you cannot run anything big. Okay? You're very nice for your own, but you cannot run anything big. To run anything big, you really have to know to put an end to all kinds of atrocities. Okay? But Esav did not choose that way. His power went all the way to, and that to show people have free will. Okay? And finally, when Jacob realizes that Esav chose the wrong way, so there's a game when he's making the stew, and he made the stew specially from red lentils. And the Zohar says, lentils are like blood. I don't know how, but you know, if you know how red blood cells look like, it's like they look like red lentils, right? And we know that dome merape dome, that similarities can heal. So we know if you want to break the blood, if somebody has his red cells are too many, eat lentils. I know that many healers or practitioners or physicians of naturopathy will say, no, how could you do that? Because lentils are full of iron. The more lentils you eat, the more red blood cells you have. I tried it on myself and it worked. It lowers your blood cells. On the contrary, why? Because the Zohar says so in this parasha. So Jacob was preparing the lentil soup because he wanted to break that redness of the red blood of Esau, to heal that. And what did he do? He basically said to him, sell me your birthright. Esau, the Zohar says that in that moment that he realized why he was so tired. You know, you're so tired and so hungry, but you know, there's a limit. Go and buy falafel outside. You know, why are you selling your birthright? And the Zohar explains, here we are talking about Esau. When the moment he sided with the body consciousness, and you know, the body consciousness is about me, me, and again me, correct? So what happens? Whenever I'm strong enough, I don't care about my soul. I don't care about my spirituality. I do not care about honesty. When do I do that? When I feel that my life came to an end. When I went too far. So that's why they say that there are no atheists in the foxholes. When you're hiding in the war, in the digs, and the shells are falling very close, suddenly you forget about your lusts and your desires and your all of those bodily things that you desire them. Even as a soldier, you dream one day the war will be over and I can get my spoils and so on. No, when your life is hanging there, you suddenly realize that you, if not your soul, you're finished. So suddenly you believe in God. How come? Because why? Because the human soul believes in God normally. The human soul without the body has faith, connects to God automatically. The body is there to disturb, to mask. Okay, so it's hard for us to overcome. The problem is that without the soul, the body is worth nothing. We know that. Can the body live without the soul? No. The moment the soul lives, the body is just nothing. Only good for recycling, right? Good for nothing. The body is dead. So the moment Esau went on the journey of desire to receive for the self alone, he went all the way. So, you know, what does it mean all the way? So the Midrash is saying, on that day that he came home tired, he killed, he murdered, he slept with somebody else's wife. All kinds, he did that. What does it mean? Did he really do it? I don't know. And it doesn't matter. When you go after your body desires, you'll come out exhausted. Why? All of these desires, when you fulfill them in the filthy, bodily, egotistic, right, desires, in the lowest level, it kills you. And Esau realized he's finished. He came to the finish line. He now is with, so that when Jacob is saying, I feed you in one condition, you give me the birthright. He simply gave us the example that if you want, each one of us, we all have these two forces fighting inside us. The Esau and the Jacob, it's each one of us. And Esau is stronger, as we all know. We know that the body is much stronger most of the time. And we can't just get rid of it. And the same story continues after he buys the birthright. Like he's cheating him. Like, when did you hear that you come home and your brother is cooking something and he wants you to pay for the food? You live in the same household. Since when you're asking for money? No, as you know, family, you cook and you're very excited that everybody comes home to eat, correct? That's a normal. What we're talking about is a very dysfunctional family. Okay? But the story is much deeper than that. When later on we read how, let's go to chapter 26, verse 27. 28. I'm sorry, Okay, chapter 27, verse 34. ויעשה בן 40 שנה, ויקח אישה את יהודית בבארי החיתי, ואת בוסמת בתילון החיתי. And Esav is 40 years old and he's marrying two Canaanite or Hittite women. ותהיינה מורת רוח ליצחק ולרבקה, and it was very upsetting for יצחק and רבקה. At that moment they already know that Esav chose to get off the derech, off the way. Okay, but then chapter 20, that's chapter 26, I'm sorry, 34 and 35. Chapter 27, verse 1. And then Isaac got older. He couldn't see. And he calls Esav and he asks him the famous story. Cook, go and hunt for me. Cook for me and I'll give you my blessing. Rivka hears that and she runs to Jacob. And she says, your father is going to give the blessing. Go and steal the blessing. And Yaakov is horrified. Why? He's an innocent man. He's an innocent man. Without Rivka, he will never know how to do it. No, I'm telling you what you're going to do. I'm going to cook for you the food the way your father likes it. I'm going to put the fur of the goats on you. So when Yitzchak will touch you, he will feel the hair. You will think this is Esav. Okay? And Jacob does it. And Isaac is having a suspicion. But finally he gives the blessings to Jacob. And then when Esav is coming, and Isaac immediately knows that he gave the blessing to Jacob. He says to him, your brother came and he stole your blessing. And Esav is crying. You don't bless me, father. No, I don't. I gave him the blessing already. You don't have enough blessing, father. Give me a blessing. So Isaac finally gives him a blessing after he cries a lot. So we're asking the question, how come Isaac did not see what a rasha, what a terrible person Esav is, and how righteous is Jacob? And the answer is that he did see that. How do we know he did see that? Because when he's blessing Jacob, by at the end of the story, the end of the parasha, that's in chapter 28, verse 1. This is in this parasha, Isaac is giving three blessings. One to Jacob when he thinks this is Esav. One to Esav when he knows this is Esav. And one to Jacob when he knows it's Jacob. What kind of blessing is giving to Jacob? Chapter 28, verse 1. Vayikra Yitzchak el Yaakov, and Yitzchak calls Jacob. Vayivarech oto, and he's blessing him. Vayitzaveh veyomar lo lo tikach isha mibnot Kna'an. Do not marry a woman from the daughters of Kna'an. Kumlech Padan Aram, Beit Betuel Avi Imecha. Go to Padan Aram, to the family of your mother, and marry one of his daughters, the daughters of Lavan, your uncle. And then he says, Ve'el Shaddai Yivarech Otcha, and God will bless you, multiply you. You'll be a commonwealth of nations. And then verse 4, which is the most important verse in the whole parasha. Ve'iten lecha et birkat Avraham. And he will give you the blessing of Abraham. When he was able to give that blessing to Esav, twice, he did not give that blessing. The blessing of Abraham, which means Isaac never thought that Esav continues the road. Never thought so. Never believed so. He knows that he can trust Jacob and Jacob will continue the road. He will complete the mission of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay? The mission of that God gave them. Okay? He never thought that Esau is the one. So why did he give him the blessing? Why did he give Esau that blessing when he thought it is Esau? And the answer is very simple. In this world, our world of today, for the last few thousand years, when you look around, who is in charge? Let's say you go to school as a kid. Who's in charge? Who's the biggest bullies in the class? The Esavs or the Yaakovs? Who is everybody serving? The Esavs or the Yaakovs? How many times as a parent you send your kids to school and you know sooner or later they're going to be bullied or they're going to bully somebody else? They'll have to fight. They'll have to understand that life is not about ultimate justice. Life is about ongoing fight all the time. Many times, you'll have to know, like Jacob and like Rivka, you cannot come and say, this is wrong. You know, people today, you know, for the name of justice, everything should change right now. Does that happen? Almost never. Almost never. You have to be smarter as Jacob. You always have to be a few steps ahead. Vayazed nazid, your mind should be creative and look forward. And that's how the Jacobs along the last few millennia survived. And little by little, they corrected by this, the sin of Adam. We all carrying the sin of Adam. We all, the moment that Adam and Eve ate from the tree of knowledge, as we spoke about last week, Esav, the snake, got the birthright. Our job is step by step, making the chatira, digging under him, creating more positivity and more positivity, behind his back, under his feet. Because going there and saying, because we are righteous, because we are honest, we deserve to be worshipped, never works. And whoever says that, in a history, you know today, they were always Esav in disguise. It was the voice of Jacob, but it was the hands of Esav. That was always in history. Always those people who pretended to be the most righteous, the most loving in the name of truth and justice, these are the ones that robbed humanity, that enslaved humanity generation after generation. Okay? Especially in the last 2,000 years, 1,500 years. Before that, it was really, the truth is, before that, it was really awesome to rob people. I don't think the Romans had any shame that they simply enslaved, robbed, colonized the whole world around them. They have no problem. I don't think they have any problem. They had no shame bringing their slaves to the Colosseum that was also robbed from the temple in Jerusalem and see this reality show. They had no shame. But you know what? The Jacobs were digging under slowly, slowly. And little by little, the rules of the game start to change. We are right now in one of the last rounds. This is why everything is fake. Everything, you don't know who to trust. Why is it? Because everything comes to the surface. And everybody is mixed up. Because for centuries and centuries, humanity has been robbed. Has been cheated. And now that the truth is surfacing, and you don't know who to believe to. Okay? So first of all, you have to go inside and find the central column inside. When you find that central column, when you connect to that central column, when you learn how to behave in a way of desire to receive for the sake of sharing, and as we said, Rabbi Akiva said, the whole Torah, the general rule of the whole Torah is loving others as you love yourself. How do I know I'm connecting to the central column. And what was his name again? Rabbi Akiva. In his name is Yaakov. Right? Akiva has the same letters as Yaakov. He tried to correct it. He tried. Because when you can feel unconditional love to people, you know you're going the right direction. When you're feeling judgment, criticism, intolerance towards other people, go back. You didn't get out of your dungeon. You're still in the dungeon of self-righteousness, selfishness, and so on. Waiting for justice to appear is very Isavik. Let's go and kill all the bad guys and everything will be great. It never worked. It never worked. So we have still needing to follow Jacob, to be patient, to be positive. But if we awaken that power of fire of Isaac, of the prayer, and that fire of Esau, and we harness it with the innocence of Jacob, we'll finally have the power that the Jacobs will take over the world, and finally we can see the messianic ages coming. But there's a long journey. Meanwhile, we need a lot of patience and a lot of self-work. Thank you so much, and have a great week.